Reverend Father, bless the proclaimer of the gospel, the holy apostle and evangelist Mark.
May the Lord, through the prayers of the holy, glorious, and illustrious apostle and evangelist Mark, grant that you proclaim the word with great power for the fulfillment of the gospel of his beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Wisdom, let us stand and listen to the holy gospel. Peace be to all.
And to your spirit.
A reading from the holy gospel according to Saint Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord. Glory to you.
Let us be attentive.
Here begins the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In Isaiah the prophet it is written, I send my messenger before you to prepare your way, a herald's voice in the desert, crying, make ready the way of the Lord, clear him a straight path. Thus it was that John the Baptizer appeared in the desert, proclaiming a baptism of repentance, which led to the forgiveness of sins. All the Judean countryside and the people of Jerusalem went out to him in great numbers. They were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. John was clothed in camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist. His food was grasshoppers and wild honey. The theme of his preaching was, one more powerful than I is to come after me. I am not fit to stoop and untie his sandal straps. I have baptized you in water. He will baptize you in the Holy Spirit.
Glory to you, O Lord. Glory to you. The Holy Ghost descends upon you. And the power of the Most High, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you.
Christ is born.
Glorified.
Christos resuscitatio. Father Vassal, Father Deacon Bill, parishioners of St. Joseph, today we celebrate a number of feasts. We celebrate the circumcision. 8 days after the birth of Jesus, he was, like every good Jewish boy, taken to the temple to be circumcised and dedicated to the Lord, to be given a name. And so now, January 1st, 8 days after Christmas, we celebrate the circumcision. We also celebrate the new year. This is also the feast of St. Basil the Great. So in honor of St. Basil, we pray today the liturgy of St. Basil. So strap in, it's the long one with the extra prayers. And we also celebrate the Sunday before Theophany, before the baptism of our Lord. So yesterday they got like four homilies. I'll see if I can give it down to just like two homilies at this time. But what I'd like to propose is that perhaps we can think a little bit about names and a little bit about water. And since there's so many little kids, I'll add one more story about how we might understand the world. So Jesus gets a name today, and it's a name that's a beautiful name that Scripture tells us is a powerful name. In Genesis, God begins by naming the stars and the sky, by naming the night and the day, and then he names Adam and Eve. And when he names those stars in the sky, and when he names those planets, he says that they're good. But when he names Adam and Eve, he says they're very good. But today, in the gospel, we hear that Jesus is not only the name of Jesus, but God looks at him and says he's not just good and very good, but he's beloved. And so you and I think, are invited to recognize today that God looks at you and at me and names us by name and says that you are my beloved son, you are my beloved daughter. That God looks at us and names us not just as good, but as loved. And because that name is something that orients us and places us in reality, when we name something, we're able to create an understanding of where it fits in the world. Adam was given a task to name all the animals. God didn't name every single thing, but in fact, Adam had a job to also name things. St. Irenaeus of Lyon talks about how Adam and Eve probably fell because they were just little children and ignorant. They were newly created. And so it's not like Augustine who says they were intensely prideful and that's why they fell. Irenaeus has a nicer little version where he says they're just ignorant, dumb kids, and that's why they fell. And so I can imagine a little tiny 8-year-old Adam holding God by the hand and God saying, what should we call this one? He says, bear. And then we'll call this one a fox and that one a lion. And he gets to name these things. And the beautiful thing is that when the Bible continues on in Exodus and in Leviticus and in Numbers, when God says, these are the good things and the good animals that are kosher and these are the unkosher animals, he uses those same names that Adam would have given them. That God allows us to share in the act of naming, to share in the act of orienting ourselves in the world and moving us from the disorder of the world into an order that we share and participate in. So imagine what it would be like if we could see ourselves and name ourselves the way God sees us and names us, the way God sees us with love. Taking an eye towards theophany, towards the baptism of Christ, which we'll celebrate later this week, that same image of moving from what is unnamed and unknown to what is ordered appears in the beautiful image of water. That in Genesis, we also hear the Spirit hovers over the water when the world is just formless in a wasteland and disordered. And water, this great image of disorder, and ends up becoming ordered. We pray in the Psalms that at his rebuke, they took to flight and the waters that stood higher than the mountains ran over the hills and ran down to the place he had appointed for them. And so this water that was once disordered becomes ordered. When the priest makes the preparation of the gifts before the liturgy, the priest places the veils on top of the bread and the wine that represent you and me. And he places those veils on there and he says, the rivers have lifted up, O Lord, the rivers have lifted up their waves, more glorious than the surgings of the sea. The Lord is glorious on high, and he covers the bread. And so what this water that once covered the earth in a sign of disorder now covers these gifts in a sign of order, of God's love. And then he says, hide me in the shadow of your wings. Drive away from us every enemy and foe. Make our life peaceful. And covers them with the veil. And so there, this image that was once disordered now becomes ordered. That God holds us and carries us and shelters us. And that's what we celebrate ritually every day before the liturgy. And it's what we celebrate every day in our life. That God takes the disorder of our life and turns it into order through love. So in the new year, we want to create something new. And so many times we have these white-knuckling New Year's resolutions that I'll just force myself through it. What I'd like to propose is that if we could just see ourselves the way God sees us and looks at us with love and calls us beloved, like he calls Jesus beloved, that all of those white-knuckling efforts could just become a little bit easier and a little bit more in line with God's will and not just our will. One final little story. So I was in a church, well, just outside a church in Rome called San Clemente, and I saw this one-legged pigeon, and he was missing his foot. He had just a little stump, like a little pirate. And there was this pigeon with like his little pirate leg pecking at a little bit of food that he could find on the steps outside San Clemente in Rome. And he would gradually get his effort together and make a big hop, two hops together, and he would hop up onto the next step and peck around for a little bit of food. And I felt sorry for this pigeon because he only had one leg and he looked pretty hungry. But then a miracle happened. This pigeon put 2-3 hops together and flew off. And all of a sudden I realized, why did I feel sorry about this pigeon with one leg? He didn't feel sorry for himself. He had this incredible ability to fly. The one leg didn't bother him at all. Like, I'm worried about him hopping around, and here he could fly the whole time. And so I think it is with you and with me, We get our New Year's resolutions and we get our efforts at wanting to fix this and change that in the world. And it's so tiny. It's just so small. It's the one-legged pigeon of ourselves. And if we could just see how God loves us, we could put two or three hops together and fly. If we could just understand that God looks at us with love and calls us beloved, what could 2023 be like if we could for just a moment feel like that pigeon and recognize that we're called to fly? We're called to love with the same love that God's given us. If we could live out of that, that would order our life. And everything, all our good deeds and all our actions would flow from that love. So let's pray that the Lord, who moves our world from disorder into order, who gives us names and calls us beloved and wraps us in his love, just like we wrap these gifts of bread and wine, so that God empowers us with love. Let us embrace it and accept it this year in 2023.